You've joined the Betamax Video Club, rewinding back to our favourite films of the 1980s. My name's Rich Nelson, and today I've rented Aliens. Watching it with me is Simon Pegg. Hi, Simon, how are you?
Hi, Rich. I'm very well. Thanks for inviting me back to have a chat with you about Aliens.
My pleasure, and thank you for bringing this Betamax copy. And let's just say this up front, thank you for bringing a Betamax copy of Aliens the Special Edition, which we both watched in preparation for this.
Is there any other version we'd be watching? No, not really.
No, you know, I'm always one for the original is best and everything, but let's be honest, I think in this case, all the bits they've added in really, really did help. But what's so special about Aliens for you?
Oh, right. Well, yeah, I suppose it's not too much of a surprising question to be asked, first of all. It's a film that has taken me a while to get to love. It's something that I was railing against when I sort of first saw it, because I'm a big fan of Ridley Scott's original. But every time I've watched Aliens, there's always been something new I found. It's always expanded. The narrative has just been perfect with it. And it's just become a lot more fun to watch. Time in, time out. And add to that, every time that Ridley Scott adds a new entry to the Alien franchise in the recent years, I've gone back and enjoyed Aliens more for what it is. So it's great fun, and I'm really looking forward to talking with you about it.
I agree with you there. I think, I have an adoration of the original, which is strange because, I mean, it's not an 80s film. I shouldn't be allowed to even watch it, but it's one of my favourite films of all time. I've seen it at the cinema several times on various re-releases and things like that. And I have seen this, Aliens, as well. And coming at it now, it's weird. Look, when you look back and think of how sequels... Obviously, these days, everything's part of a franchise, and we're still getting Aliens or Alien movies coming out. And I'll be honest, I haven't seen Alien, the recent one. Was that Covenant?
Covenant, yes.
Yeah, I haven't seen that one yet. And I've got...
Lee said.
Yes. Yeah. But I have such feelings about the first two movies. And this one, in the way that a sequel these days is more of the same. Everything's... bigger, better, more explosions, blood, whatever. And this one, and I suppose, you know, you have to be sensible about certain films, and that if you're going to make a sequel to a film like Alien, you can't do Alien again, because how can you beat that? What James Cameron and the writers and everyone else have done with this is take it, inject it with pretty much everything, sort of testosterone, explosions, action, and take it to a level that I wouldn't call it an equal, because it's almost a completely different film.
You've taken those words exactly out of my mouth. It's something that was said to me a few years ago when I was trying to weigh up the difference between the two. And it's that if you treat them as two completely standalone films, but just in the shared universe, it all made sense. Cameron, when he was filming The Terminator, already had the ideas in mind, and he'd already approached studios to make a sequel to Alien. And I think he's got on record that says that a lot of the set pieces in The Terminator, in his mind, were sort of dry runs, if you like, for some of the details he would eventually put into Aliens. So he had the vision for that for quite a number of years beforehand. And I think his passion for what he wanted to do very much on screen all the time.
It's funny that that sort of the closeness between Aliens and Terminator, you've got James Cameron, you've got a lot of the cast of either Terminator or Terminator 2 appear here. And when we're talking about special edition, and I won't go into it too much, but there's a particular scene that's added in there, which is we're on the colonized planet of LV-426, where these large, huge vehicles are travelling around the surface. And it looks almost like a different version of the scenes from the future in the first Terminator film, where these, you know, these robots and machines, you know, it just looks so... It's like you're watching Terminator again, and that's a good
film. It is. Yeah, it is. Absolutely.
I mean, this film, you know, for... Again, I always put this kind of disclaimer at the start of the podcast. If you haven't seen it, please go and see it, then come back, because a lot of this either won't make sense or it sounds a little bit far-fetched, because, you know, this is set, I didn't write down the year, but this is set 57 years after the first movie. And, you know, after the events of the Nostromo and Ripley's managed to escape in her cryo sleep tube with the cat. And she's been drifting around in space for 57 years. I mean, this is like Buck Rogers without the silver costumes.
To put it in sort of context of what we're dealing with now, with everything going on in the world, it's, you know, she had a really bad encounter with a bad bug in the previous film, so decided to self-isolate for 57 years. And, you know, she's just coming back into the world. So, yeah, and I think that actually helps the separation between the first film and this one, having that period of time. It's just another thing to add which separates the two films and makes them stand on their own.
And the fact that she's sort of found drifting around, and, you know, but it's hard to gather in the current climate, you know, the context of space and everything. I mean, the last week at the time of recording this, there was a rocket's gone off to Mars, and then this is in the depths of space. And in the meantime, you know, she's been asleep, and that they have a name, but they're always referred to as the company, colonized the planet where they encountered the alien the first time round. And it's just, again, it's as much of a satire as such of corporate America or corporate culture, where, you know, they see how can we make money, how can we exploit natural resources, and, you know, completely disregard the fact that there are aliens and, you know, put people's lives at jeopardy.
It's become probably more relevant in today's world than maybe it was even 20 years ago.
Now, in your kind of day job in working in planning and architecture and building people's dream homes and stuff, I mean, what do you think of LV-426? Would that be somewhere that you'd look to put someone?
I think Kevin MacLeod has had his work cut out trying to get a special out there, and I wouldn't necessarily like to, you know, suggest that one of the clients becomes the project manager on that, but I mean, it's serving a purpose. I mean, it is explained obviously in the film that it's a work in progress, the shake and bake facility. So, you know, the atmospheric process and everything, it's a little bit industrial for my particular tastes, but I think they're getting there.
You know, we meet the kind of company's stooge, or the face of the company is Paul Reiser as Burke, who I've just written in brackets is a shit.
Yes, sort of the Eric Trump of the company, perhaps.
I mean, the way that he meets Ripley, he, you know, very, he, I guess, looking back with a hindsight, you know he's a bastard from the beginning, but watching this for the first time, he is that kind of probably promoted early. He's like one of these hungry young executives in, you know, and again, it kind of shows in how in 1986 they viewed the future, and what do people in the future wear? Well, the jackets on their suits, you know, the collar is up. So
I noticed that as well, the top part and everything. Yeah, he's perfectly cast. He is the stereotypical sort of businessman stroke villain, if you like, that you could have found in any number of 80s films. And he just plays it to perfection, and he throughout the film until his eventual end. Yeah,
I mean, he explains to Ripley, you know, I mean, this is where you kind of feel that's how long she's been asleep. Her young daughter has died at the age of 66.
Yes,
God.
Yeah, I'll see, which leads on to one of the, you know, sort of additional scenes, if you like, in the extended edition, which I think really helps the film. Going back to what you said at the start about, you know, why I like the film, and every time I watch it, something new I get from it. And when I was younger, sort of in the mid to late teens, watching it, you go in there, you want the action film, you want all the bravado and everything. The older you get, you actually realise how the narrative is structured, and it really provides a perfect arc for Ripley throughout. She comes from the sort of post-traumatic stress of the first film, deals with the fact, you know, she is displaced out of time, she's lost her daughter, and then by the end of the film, she has completely come almost full circle back to where she was at the start of the first film. You know, she's got the confidence and very much in the lead.
It just seems to go like, and I know, you know, we talked about this on other episodes about how studios will trim bits of fat from movies in order to, whether it's to condense them so they can have more screenings and thus make more money, or whether they feel that it slows the film down and things like that. But when you read about the scenes that they put in and when you watch them, they just seem to make so much sense, as you say, for the narrative arc throughout the film, that it makes you wonder why they would take that part out.
Yeah, particularly the piece when she's sort of looking at the photo of Quentin, which incidentally is a photo of Sigourney Weaver's mother, if I remember rightly from the trivia. But that obviously then sets up for then her later sort of attachment to Newt and trying to protect her. It just very much, all the little pieces are being sort of laid, all the breadcrumbs are being laid, which eventually get picked up later in the film. And that's a theme throughout, yeah.
I think you're damn lucky to be alive, kiddo. You could be floating out there forever. Is you okay?
And we've had this scene on the hospital bay where Ripley's having these bad dreams, one in particular where she wakes up and genuinely believes that she's got an alien bursting out of her. It's just to kind of ground you back in the reality and the horror of the original film. And it really shows the levels of trauma that she'd gone through, that this is what she's dreaming of. It's quite a graphic way to start the film.
It's also the thing, the first film took a long time to get to that particular scene with the chest burst, which obviously came out of sort of nowhere, on her, but in terms of pacing of the film. Whereas this, they decided, you know, within the first 10 to 15 minutes or something, you need to be reminded of what it was. That then sort of, as you rightly say, it then gives you the thought of where Ripley is in her own mind, dealing with everything. And yeah, it's a very effective piece.
And the concept of this, and she's basically, let's call it an inquest into her actions of the first film, which so again is pushing that kind of corporate, you know, everyone's got to be accountable for their actions, and the whole essence of she's destroyed this ship, which cost millions of dollars, and they've got the
42 million dollars apparently.
I mean, you could just write that off as a tax rebate or something like that. I mean, that's probably how Amazon look at these things. And in the background, and something that got pointed out to me quite recently was where they're showing the old crew from the Nostromo in the background. And one thing that someone raised was that Lambert, the character who's played by Veronica Cartwright, was actually shown as a trans person, and she transitioned from male to female. And I mean, a big deal wasn't made about it, but I think if you watch the film in super high definition, you can actually see that in writing at the back, which I thought was an interesting touch.
It was actually, yeah, that's really good.
So we cut, and again, this is a special edition thing where they cut off to LV-426, where the original encounter happened. And there's these Terminator-style machines going around, and the whole concept of building better worlds. And this is where the corporation are there, you know, terraforming this planet to make it suitable for inhabitation.
Yeah.
And we meet Newt and her family going off to, investigate some interesting which you know from movies never ends well.
The Hadley's Hope, where this is based on LV-426, it has no crash facilities, so Newt's mum and dad have to take the kids with them on barren landscapes on an alien planet, you know, strap in kids, we're here for the duration. Just sort of wandering around the planet and obviously making claims on anything that they find.
It's an odd one. I guess they obviously didn't. I mean, these days it would be childcare and everything else. And that was, I could go off on this huge rant about childcare bills and how much that costs. But now it's just on planet Earth, or 200 yards from my house. But the fact that it's called Hadley's Hope, and I know we joked previously about being a whole Spandau Ballet thing. And it's almost like they're on some sort of gold rush or something.
Oh, Oh, yes. And does Tony get any sort of residuals when the aliens break through the barricades and all that kind of thing? Yeah.
True, true, true. But
oh,
sorry. Sorry.
I don't need this pressure. God.
Oh, I can't joke about my former school alumni like that. It's, you know, terrible stuff. Now, because I'm not sure what the time lapse here is, that Ripley's been discharged from the company. She's off. She's working, and Burke the shit and goes to convince her that, you know, it's that kind of, oh, we've lost contact with the colony.
Yes, also accompanied by, what was it, Gorman in his sort of first appearance, the world's worst marine.
He's one of these direct entry officers that you get now. He's straight in with no experience.
He's a work experience, yeah. Mm. Yeah.
And they eventually convince her that she can go off to the planet as an advisor because, again, she's had contact with these aliens, and this is, oh, we'll just take you along. It's all very, you know, come along as an advisor. You know, with the benefit of hindsight, we know what happens. But this is a military operation with the U.S. colonial marines, who are a crack outfit. And how was it you described them on your notes?
Team America off World Police.
Very appropriate.
Yes, you know, just send them on a ship and they'll just go and blow shit up and, yeah, they'll make it all right. America, fuck yeah.
I mean, we meet them on the Sulaco, which is their ship, where, again, there's something that's enhanced a little bit, where they show the barren ship as everyone's in this cryo sleep, and they wake up, you know, Ripley's there, but you've got essentially the cast of Marines who are a bit of a ragtag bunch in various ways, and it's just so, again, like, there are a few cliches in there. There's the always great Bill Paxton as Hudson.
Oh, yes. Oh,
it's fantastic.
Yeah. Yeah. The whole crew just gelled from the start, and it was deliberate when sort of Cameron was filming. This scene where you first meet the Marines was the last scene that they all filmed together. The idea being that after about 9-10 months of filming, all the sort of cast and crew would have got to know each other, bonded and everything. The first time we see them by filming this class, they've already got that sort of camaraderie. You already feel like they've been through it all together. They've got the relationship going, and it just worked really well. There's a lot of sort of playing off with each other, and, you know, Bill Paxton, you know, improvised quite a number of lines throughout the film. It all just comes from them having got to know each other on filming, and it really comes across well. You've got a proper theme in front of you.
And some of the lines in there, I mean, you've got the Sarge, Al Matthews, who, you know, he's always great when I've seen him in anything. I mean, again, he was in Superman 3 for token Superman reference. But, you know, as Sergeant Appone, and when Bill Paxton moans about the floor being cold, he's like, do you want me to fetch your slippers for you? And he's very much a Marine from start to finish, with the old, you know, really talking. The Marines are great. It's reminding these people.
Yeah, Al Matthews, obviously chosen as a Marine sergeant in the film. A little bit of sort of movie trivia to throw in here. He was the first real-life black Marine to be promoted to the rank of sergeant in the field during Vietnam.
He's had a varied career, and he'll be the person playing out the podcast with one of his songs. So.
Yes, yes.
And all this, we've got... you know, we're meeting Hudson and Hicks and Vasquez, and there's, you know, the kind of what you'd expect, that macho, there's a lot of that testosterone, and, you know, this is just talking about Vasquez as well. You know, there's a lot of jokes at her expense about, and she comes back with some good comebacks when Bill Paxton says to her, have you ever been mistaken for a man? And she says, no, have you?
It's brilliant. The whole film is chock full of lines that everyone can quote. It's just got a little bit of something for everyone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we also meet Bishop, who's Lance Henriksen. And this is the kind of,
yes,
I guess, a callback to the first movie as well, where, I mean, the scene where he has Bill Paxton's hand and doing, everyone knows, the knife sort of trick, where moving the knife between his fingers, and it transpires that he's a, well, he calls himself a synthetic person, I think, or an android, and obviously Ripley gets these immediate sort of chills because of what happened with the android from the previous film.
It's a wonderful introduction to the character. He'd only obviously been seen in the periphery on, you know, the crew shots and everything. His first introduction in this big film, which by his own admission was the film that was either going to make him or break him as an actor. And he was, if this didn't work out, I think he was going to go and do something else. But his first introduction, within sort of 5 minutes, he's there doing this iconic knife trick on Bill Pullman's character. He's fantastic. And it's, I love this film. And he's one of the reasons I love it.
I wonder how many idiots have lost fingers due to doing this after a few beers.
Yeah, probably not enough. Not enough, yeah.
I suppose this is Jim Cameron's way of doing natural selection.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, Bill Paxton wasn't aware that Henriksen was actually going to do this for real. I think it was Henriksen's idea to have a chance. It was originally going to be done on his own hand, and they sort of, eventually a few of them got together and thought, no, we'll do it with Bill Paxton. It just works better.
And one thing that, again, is slight spoiler when you talk about future things, but I think you can't really talk about a spoiler of a film that's 34 years old. You've got Bill Paxton and Lance Henriksen are, I believe, the only actors to have been killed on or killed by an alien, a predator, and a Terminator.
That's the one. I'm glad we've done it. I love little bits of trivia like that, and I'm glad we brought that one up. Yeah. It's fantastic.
I mean, that's one of these disputed things because, I mean, Bill Paxton, obviously, the Terminator killed him at the start of that film. He died in Predator 2 and, again, in this. And yet there's some query because Lance Henriksen, how he came to his end in this story was that at the start of Alien 3, being an android, he's kind of, I mean, he wasn't a human, but he kind of ceased to exist because of the actions of the alien. And then he was killed by a predator in one of those awful Alien versus Predator films. So I guess if you're talking canon, who knows? But it's always nice to hear those stats.
It is.
It's a shame Michael Biehn wasn't in a Predator film as well, because he would have met the same fate.
Oh, no, there's still time.
They're still making Predator films. He's probably still working. Now, as the Marines are heading down to the planet, they get in their craft, and we get another sort of classic Paxton. I believe this was an ad lib as well. He says,
"Five. We're on express elevator to hell, going down.
2-1, mark."
And this is the part where they're dropping out of their ship onto the planet, and this is where the world's worst Marine. So, oh, no, how many drops have you done? He said, 38 simulated. Yeah. There's only so much you can learn from a computer.
Yes, Twitter teaches us daily.
talking learning from Twitter, I mean, and one thing, one recurring theme that we get throughout is mansplaining, which I know is something you pointed out. And
Hicks, who is probably the equivalent of the male hero in this, he's obviously trying to do his best by Ripley, but throughout there are little bits and pieces where he's the 1986 equivalent of a mansplainer to Ripley. He explains everything. It's obviously, you know, done for the audience so they can pick up on what it, but he does constantly look out for Ripley and sort of explain how everything works to her throughout, which must be a little bit galling. But
when you think about sort of Ripley being viewed now as one of the iconic action heroes, you know, and nothing to do with gender, I mean, she genuinely, having survived the first film and this, and I say survived, you know, won at the end, and I was almost tempted to keep a little tally of when Hicks would actually use the word actually, or I think you'll find, or something like that. It's the mansplaining 101. But
yes
enjoyable.
Not bad for a brunt.
Now, when they land on the planet, they find all these things that we immediately now know as kind of calling cards for the aliens. There's sort of holes in the ceilings and the floors from acid. And
I've worked with builders like that, yes.
Just leave things lying around like that.
Oh, yeah. Milk and two sugars, please,
Health and safety gone mad. It was probably the people who did my bathroom floor, to be honest. We find, because again, being Team America, they open fire on everything that moves, and they almost shoot the young girl who's, it was her father who had the face hugger attached to him that pretty much started this whole thing. He's off prospecting and gets a John Hurt to the face. And she's hiding now. She's obviously, I'm not sure what the time lapse is, again, for, I mean, we're probably talking a period of weeks, maybe. She's very dirty. She's got a little hideout. This young blonde girl, who I think is, what, 8 or 9? Ripley, because, as you said earlier, we know more of her narrative, that she has lost her daughter, and it sounds awful to say she's taken Newt as a replacement, but she certainly is mumsy towards her, and I think that's gets her through.
I think that really helps the film. Otherwise, it is just a load of guys with guns going to a planet and basically shooting the place up because there's really no one else there. But having that little sort of reaction, having that character there, it's just really nice. It just takes it into a slightly different direction, and it just gives Sigourney Weaver much, much more to do. And it's a much better film for it.
Yeah, I mean, there is a lot of showing of a humanity to her, that, you know, she isn't just this hero who gets through this. I mean, this is what sets it apart from, I guess, maybe say a Predator, for example, where, you know, what's the goal? Survive. But, you know, as we see later on, where she makes a decision when they escape from the planet, but she goes back to save Newt. You know, this is her redemption. Well, redemption sort of sounds lame, but her arc where she becomes her mother. And then we see it again. It's a theme that goes throughout the films then, certainly the sequels that she's in, where you go into the third movie where, unfortunately, spoiler, the character of Newt dies, and then she becomes pregnant with an alien. And you know, again, it's that kind of, and I don't know if that's a kind of thing that, and I know you can, you know, because she's a woman, it's easier to do that, you know, and to give her that kind of arc as opposed to just a survival, being this Schwarzenegger hero. But at least it allows us that extra dimension of her character where she's not just, if it bleeds, we can kill it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And as I say, it's otherwise, you know, sustaining, we watched the special edition, but sustaining action piece, set piece, big action, all the way through for 2.5 hours, it does, you know, weary you after a while. So having these little sort of personal moments, I love the moment where it's just a simple moment where Ripley is just cleaning Newt's face with hot chocolate, you know, because of the little patch that she made clean. And I just think that's a lovely sort of gentle everything going on around them, and it's just something that completely brings the pair of them together.
Yeah, and the fact that, you know, we can only imagine what Newt had gone through prior to this, that having Ripley there to kind of, you know, she's the only one that she initially speaks to, coaxes her out. And again, throughout the film, you know, this young girl shows a toughness that, and it's pointed out to Hudson as well at one point, you know, she survived it with no weapons, no training, and he's acting like a big child, saying game over, man, to everything.
Yeah. Absolutely. It's a nice way just to give the characters, all of the characters, someone to bounce off against in terms of where they actually are.
Now, we need to establish that, where have all these people from the colony gone? You know, there aren't many dead bodies lying around. They've all conveniently had trackers surgically implanted into them before they've gone off to the planet. So when they find the trackers, they're all in one place. And there's a good line there of that, oh, are they having a town meeting? And it turns out, as we find in the next scene, that they're all essentially being held in a nest for alien eggs to implant them and turn them into more aliens. It's, you know, when you think about how the first movie had one alien with the element of surprise and suspense, it was almost like it was like Jaws in that way. Whereas this is kind of, we are breeding aliens, so we have loads of them.
Absolutely. I mean, the title kind of gives that away, which is quite nice as well. Kind of, how much, you know, how many are we talking? I mean, two, are we talking three? But no, we're going to chuck you straight into a nest with it. I mean, you already knew from the previous film that there were hundreds or thousands of eggs here. So the expectations were probably high going into this. And yeah, it's nicely but slowly delivered into what everyone is actually getting themselves into.
And the nest itself is, horrifying. You know, you go in there and see all these humans. I mean, we find, was it the one woman who's there and saying, kill me? I mean, yes. I don't know how long they've been there, but they're basically being kept alive in order to act as hosts. I mean, it's awful. And, you know, the way that the whole set was laid out with the whole construct and the bits of alien skin and whatever substances they're using to hold them together. I didn't realize until quite recently that that was also the set from Batman.
Yes, the actor's chemicals plant as well. So, yeah. I mean, in terms of interior decorating, I'm going back to sort of Kevin MacLeod territory here, but I've seen worse decisions in real life in terms of the alien myth. It's just a truly horrifying set. It takes the sort of little scene from the first film with Tom Skerritt's character, which is the extended version of that, where he's sort of cocooned up and it's gone overboard. They've just decided, yes, yeah, we're in the nest. We actually need to see everything. And it's beautifully lit. It just gives you enough to completely terrify you that this is where everyone is. Yeah.
And you think about, you know, some of the, I mean, we know it from the annals of history that James Cameron makes enormous films. I mean, we've had Titanic and Avatar, and I guess part of his, when we look back on his body of work, is that he's made things big. He turned Terminator, which was, you know, in many regards quite a small movie that did really well, and he then made Terminator 2, you know, this groundbreaking film with special effects and everything. And yet this, I believe at one point he was writing Terminator, this, and First Blood Part 2 at the same time, and he had three different desks for each of those movies.
It's phenomenal. Yeah,
I mean, how he's met, I mean, of course, I won't go too much into Avatar, because like most of Avatar, I just fall asleep halfway through. But I mean, it had Sigourney Weaver in it. But the, you know, we're in this part now where it gives you that scale and it gives you an idea of what they're up against. And even when, you know, we've got the eggs, we've got the bodies, we've got these face huggers, we get a mini chest bursting scene.
Lovely. Of the woman it's everything you want, and it's almost drip fed to you throughout the film of your expectations from the first film. You want your chest burst, you eventually want to be the big alien, and it's nicely drip fed to you in some quite really nice big set pieces, which, you know, they're very memorable when you see them.
And then you get the sort of panic scene where one of them is grabbed and the guy holding the bag of ammunition, the bag blows up, and there's the, you know, essentially the Marines find out what they're up against. This isn't just a rescue colony, or as it, as one of them commented, reuniting them with their virginities. This is like an alien species that pretty much on a bigger scale of what Ripley had said had happened in the first movie.
Yeah.
And now they're in an alien nest being grabbed and, oh God,
it's a brilliant, it's everything that you wanted to build up to, and it's beautifully played, because obviously the set is only so big and it have quite a big impact if you've got all these aliens coming at you. And they do a lovely trick, obviously, as well, of interspersing those shots with cameras mounted on the helmets. You actually see a lot as the actual Marines see them as well, and I think it's a nice little way of sort of balancing, making it as realistic as possible, given the constraints of time and prosthetics and all of that. And it's got a sense of urgency to it, and it really does pack a punch. It's a proper devastating moment for the entire team.
And Ripley, who in her advisory role is still sort of outside, mounts a sort of big rescue mission in this tank that they've got, and bursts in and kills a few. And of course, you know, we're starting to lose Marines now with, you know, this is where, is it, what's the name of the guy who's Vasquez's best mate, when he gets sprayed in the face, Drake, by the alien. Because I didn't twig until last night watching it, he was the rapey inmate from Shawshank Redemption as well.
Of course, yes. Yeah, Drake, yeah, not Dietrich. Yes, of course, yeah.
And so Vasquez and him are separated because they'd already had this very it's hard to describe the relationship between them, but you know, you probably imagine that what they got up to when they weren't on missions, and they were all very, you know, admiring of each other anyway.
Absolutely. It's almost like a little sort of buddy movie in there with just the two of them, completely separate from everyone else. It's lovely.
Yeah. And Hudson, you know, being peak Hudson, is, you know, saying it can't be happening. And this is the conversation then where Burke pipes up to defend, because the idea is that they'll go and blow it up from outer space and destroy the whole thing. And again, Burke, with the corporate dollar in mind, is, oh no, we can't blow it up. You know, this is a multi-million dollar. And, you know, if there's any sort of person, you know, yes, the alien is the villain of the piece, but if you want to make someone really detestable, just make them talk about dollar value.
His card is almost, it's immediately marked from that point. You know, Marines have been lost. Here's a, you know, a company coming up 5 minutes later and said, well, you know, let's just hold the horses here a minute. We can't just go blowing the place up with a few Marines and I don't know, his card is marked from that point onwards.
Fucking A. Oh, hold on, 1 second. This installation has a substantial dollar value attached to it.
They can bill me.
And, you know, the craft comes in to pick him up and it crashes, and it's just, again, that there's an alien on the ship, and you get that kind of forbearing of when the guy gets on and there's a bit of like, oh, what's that on my foot? Oh, nothing. Oh, there's an alien, kills the pilot. It's just kind of, oh dear, anything that can go wrong will go wrong on this mission.
Proper slapstick at that point.
It is a little bit, because it's, you know, the pilot turns around and sees the aliens. You can always just, oh no, oh booger.
Yeah, idiot slipping on a banana skin just out of show.
And this is sort of Hudson's big game over man, because they're all, you know, how are they going to get back to the Sulaco? And Newt's sort of main line of, they mostly come at night, mostly.
That's it, man. Game over, man. It's game over. What the fuck are we going to do now? What are we going to do?
Maybe we could build a fire, sing a couple of songs, huh? Why don't we try that?
We better get back, because it'll be dark soon, and they mostly come at night, mostly.
Absolutely.
And so their plan is to fortify the colony, and again, it's that, you know, as we suggested about earlier, the through the barricades. And they found within the complex, there's some scientific labs where some of the face huggers have been kept alive, and Bishop has been ordered by Burke to keep them alive to take them back to Earth. Which again, it's just another little Burke's a bastard. They've, you know, how do they set them? It begins like a kind of self-defense thing. Then they've got these really awesome sentry guns which just fire it, and it gives you context of how many aliens there must be. And you do get a couple of clips, but
it's just another little sort of throwing in of action, which is great. I mean, obviously setting up all the barricades and in proper 80s fashion with the old welding torch. I mean, you're just really waiting for the A-team to be over the top of it as they're all going round. And again, it's that kind of thing. Yes, they're sealing themselves in. You've already had a taste of how many aliens are out there, so you're totally with them at this point. They're going to be locking themselves in, and then it's just a case of dealing with it as they come in.
I don't think many films or TV shows did more for welding than the A-Team or Flashdance in the 80s. It's one of those things. That...
I'm not sure the Flashdance soundtrack would work quite as well over the scene it had me too. But,
I don't know. There could have been some dancing, and she had quite similar hair to Ripley, I think. But Newt is in. She's got a little bed, and she's hiding under the floor. The face huggers have escaped, and they've been trapped in, and again, just showing Burke turns the camera off so that they can't see Ripley and Newt are trapped in this room in order to get the, you know, that they want Newt and Ripley as the hosts to take the aliens back. And it's really, you know, I mean, it's bad enough having, you know, we know how bad these aliens are and what they do, but that he's basically sentenced this 8 or 9 year old girl to it as well. It's horrible.
It's one of my favourite scenes in the film, and it just does a lot for, I mean, I'm a big fan of John Carpenter's thing, and you do the same with the facehuggers here. I mean, in the first film, you very rarely saw the facehugger move fluidly. And you, up to this point in this film, you don't really see it, but you know, they're quick, they're nimble. You watch it, and it's a really nicely done sequence where there is sort of absolute terror there, and it's really nicely done as a whole special effect. But this piece on its own, it's genuinely a terrifying sort of sequence, and there is a real threat there from what is essentially the minor of Alien of the whole franchise.
Mm. And you know, when eventually they manage to get themselves free, you know, Ripley sets off the alarm and they come in, and there's a little bit of, you know, all guns blazing, blump, you know, shoot everything in sight. And when Burke is basically confronted by this, and again, we're talking sort of modern day phenomenons with the mansplaining. I think this is gaslighting, where he's saying to her, "You're paranoid. You're crazy. It's, you know, you know, I'm fine. You're completely mad." It's
The first time I sort of watched Aliens on DVD, this was the scene where it quite surprised me that the language was different from the original ITV edit on TV. I had no idea the word mother actually existed until that point. But yeah, it was. I first watched the film, you know, back in whatever it was, the 90s or anything like that. And it's just this little scene in there. It sort of takes a little something away from me when all of a sudden those words come up and Ripley's laying into him. And I'm just like, I originally saw this, so yeah.
Those ITV edits of movies have a lot to answer for, I think.
The whole special of that alone, I think it's really good.
I mean, again, that's another thing that's sort of a recurring theme for episodes. And I mean, the RoboCop one was a prime example, where I think that on a recent Blu-ray release, they actually showed some of the TV edits that they used. And, you know, just some of the words they changed were scumbag to crumbag. You know, they didn't even bother, you know. I mean, there were various. I mean, it's normally an Eddie Murphy film where they'd say "forget you" instead of the obvious. But even here, you know, it's fine to have mindless violence, but you can't use any naughty words.
Absolutely.
So this, after this, the aliens are back inside the complex because they've travelled from the nest, and seen where they're all above. You know, they've got these motion trackers just to give us a little bit more of an impending peril. And it shows that they're not, it doesn't always work out sort of, are they above us, below us, because this is where they're all in a room and they've welded themselves in because that's what they do. The aliens are all above them, and then they start coming in through the ceiling, and Hudson's taken from, you know, there's some below them as well. Burke's run away because he's a coward and a bastard. You know, again, it's just proper shootout sort of stuff.
Yeah, and really sort of close quarters as well. I mean, the first one, we've been in the alien nest for the first encounter. It was really darkly lit, lots of greys and blues. And this one is deliberately lit up in red with these emergency lighting and everything. And that really helps. And it's, again, close quarters filming, a proper sense of urgency. You know, Hudson getting dispatched in a way he does, going out with lots of swear words. In between, I think the ITV edit probably had had its work cut out doing that. But it's a really good end scene. Again, another perfect set piece in this film.
And it shows something that you, again, deliberately don't get from the first movie, is the way the aliens move. The kind of way that they jump around and fly, you know, it's like something from Zombies or Evil Monkeys or something like that, where they fly around like something out of Planet of the Apes. It's a very novel way that they've shown it, because, you know, again, you're only bound by the limits of your imagination and technical issues, is how do you make that move? And some of the ways that they get around, you know, they're crawling upside down through vents and stuff like that. They're very nimble.
Yeah, they had a lot more to do, obviously. And I also think the analogy is very similar in this film. And when you're talking about the aliens, almost like the sort of zombie thing in the first film, it's very slow, very deliberate movement. You don't really see it around corners. And this film, they sort of gone the full 28 days later, and you know, these aliens can move in any way you want, run and walk and, you know, rebound off walls and everything. And a proper sort of step up, you know, more of a threat with these aliens.
And when they start escaping through, I mean, you know, we're greeted luckily by Burke being killed.
Oh, good.
Just a little bit of salvation for us there.
Yes.
I think he gets to see what his prize actually does. You know, it's a proper one. He just opened the door. He's like, oh, no, no. So they escape through the air vents, and this is, you know, the aliens eventually follow through them, and this is where Vasquez,
yes, and woman, and,
yeah, they have this kind of, they're out of bullets, they're out of ammo. What do we? Oh, we've got a grenade.
Yeah.
I suppose it's a kind of an important sacrifice that they make in blowing themselves up with all these aliens, because it allows Ripley and Hicks and Newt to get away.
And it's a nice little sort of moment for those two in their sort of last moments to sort of revert back to, I suppose, the Marine code, because obviously Vasquez claimed Borman to break, he was going to kill him, and here it is, you know, half an hour or so on, and he's actually going to end up killing both of them, but they both know it's for the greater good. So it's sort of playing into that sort of whole Marine sort of camaraderie.
Yeah, and I guess he didn't learn that from a simulation or computer program either.
No, that should go on his record.
He'll be remembered. Well, by some.
By some.
Yeah. Newt gets separated from Hicks and Ripley with this kind of convoluted wheel thing, like something out of a water mill. And the really terrifying scene that I...
yes.
She's in the water below them.
Yeah. And I always think that scene is longer than it actually is, but the moments where you just see it come out of the water, it's split second, and yet it's very iconic. I kind of wish that thing all over the posters, just Newt and the doll, and then, you know, the alien coming out of the water behind it. It's really, really iconic scene, but it's, you're probably terrified at that moment about what's going to happen to you.
I mean, it's difficult to kind of imagine that, you know, when you think as well of... the aliens have a different purpose in this movie than they do than the one in the first film, because in the first film it was killing, whereas in this film it's about taking the humans back to the nest.
Yeah, expansion. Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, it shows their kind of, I would say, evolution, because they're new, but the way that they're, what they want to achieve is different. You know, you immediately think, oh, Newt's dead, but she's not, because that's not her purpose. Still horrendously unpleasant. And again, with using a kind of 2020 Twitter thing, as the father of daughters, blah, blah, it's an unpleasant thing to see.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think it's one of the unspoken rules in cinema that, you know, you don't kill off kids in your film. And very few films I can think of that when they actually do that, and it has a problem. But, you know, we've come along with Newt. She's shown that she's resilient throughout. And you're in that sort of jeopardy. Yes, it's a wonderful, wonderful thing to throw in the film. Yeah, I'm glad he didn't, you know, it's a natural conclusion where she could have been killed. She's one of the best characters in the film, because I think she grounds everything around it.
Yeah. I mean, she does a lot. You know, she shows Ripley's character. She shows the childish Marines, you know, this is how, you know, resilient a child can be above a moaning, basically, you know, Bill Paxton's character was portrayed almost like a stroppy teenager.
And she screams a hell of a lot.
Oh, yeah.
Let's not forget, you know, she rivals, in terms of 80s screaming on the cinema, she rivals Willie Scott in Temple of Doom.
We talked about that in the Temple of Doom episode. I think Willie in that screamed 77 times. I didn't count Newt in this one, but it was quite handy as a way of locating her, because she lost her tracker watch.
She did.
But
she did.
Yeah, she's got a good set of lungs on her. Now we get back. Hicks gets some acid in the chest in the lift. Bishop is off doing his own little side mission. He's remote piloting the Avacraft from the Sulaco down. And as they fly back in, this is the part that reminded me of Spaceballs with the countdown. It's like 15 minutes to self-destruct. and I didn't realise, I mean, this must have been planned, that the actual from in the movie, in the final cut, it was actually 15 minutes.
15 minutes, yeah. And going earlier back to when we were talking about when they were first dropped on the planet, I think it's Poe or someone says about it, it's 10 seconds journey time until they get there. And if you actually time it, it is actually 10 seconds until the first boot hits on the ground outside Hadley's Hope. Yeah, this 15 minutes until everything goes kaboom.
Yeah, I suppose when you know that, it gives you a little bit more context. It's not just the, 15 minutes. Oh, wait, I thought we had, and again, this is everything in this film's iconic. The sea of Ripley heading down in the lift to get back to Newt.
Yeah.
Ripley in a lift with a flamethrower as she comes out. This is like badass Ripley now.
Yeah, I mean, you've already used the word iconic, and it is. It's the whole film, wonderful set of pieces, lovely narrative, building everyone up. We've lost a few guys on the way. We're really feeling it. How much better can this film get? And you just suddenly realise it's Ripley now on her own looking for Newt. There's already obviously been the allusion earlier in the film to there must be a queen somewhere. So it's, again, it's all been structured, and I don't think you watch it for the first time, you're never quite prepared for good this sort of last part of the film actually is.
And, we're talking about an era of films where it's the Stallones, the Schwarzeneggers, the Dolph Lundgrens, Chuck Norris, whatever, where it's one, the one man army sort of thing, where the scenes like from Commando where Schwarzenegger's basically doubling his weight in grenades and rocket launchers. Ripley does it in a way that's it suits her. She's not overdoing it. It's very much, and everything gets used. There's the little flares, the way that luckily earlier Hicks had mansplained how a gun works to her and everything else. But she goes off, and this is her, her mission now. She's gone to get Newt. She doesn't have to do this, but Ripley has to do this.
Hmm. Yeah, it's complete. It's the completion of the arc we talked about earlier in the film. She started the film with the press, with going through getting browbeaten by the company and being sort of cajoled onto this mission, realizing that she was proved right in what they've actually. And realizing that she's now actually going to take charge and deal with it. It's a wonderful story for the character to go this far, from where she was at the start to where she is at this point.
Attention, emergency. All personnel must evacuate immediately. You now have 15 minutes to reach minimum safe distance.
And as you said, the main alien villain of the piece is the Queen. And I'm sure it must be deliberate. It's having that female v female rivalry where this giant alien, and how do you, again, without, boiling it down to how do you irritate or how do you anger a woman or a female character is by threatening her kids. But then it's nature. It's if you're threatening, say, a bird in a nest, you threaten the eggs, of course she's going to get angry. So you've got Sigourney Weaver with a flamethrower basically aiming it at her eggs, and then for the Queen to back down, and all of a sudden on the way out she goes, oh, balls, and tortures them anyway.
and the hierarchy obviously on display, the emotions from the Queen through the drones, and they will sort of, there is some sort of hierarchy here. There is some understanding. They aren't just mindless killing machines. They do have a purpose. They do respond to the Queen, very much like the bee in the hive will. It's just a nice sort of evolution of the actual villain of the piece.
And some of it gets a bit, I would say silly, but the way that when Ripley and Newt go back up to the platform to wait for Bishop, they go up in one lift, and the Queen, having discarded all her egg-laying paraphernalia, she goes up in the other lift next to it.
Well, I suppose it's quicker than the stairs.
It is. and I don't know. I mean, we talk about in RoboCop, where the other droid from RoboCop can't go up and down stairs, which is why you don't get many cow villains. And I suppose that's why the Queen had to get the lift, which luckily Ripley had called for. Yeah. But yeah, it's just, I mean, they get back up to the platform. Bishop's gone, which gives you that whole, oh, these androids.
Exactly, yeah.
Luckily, Bishop does get there in time, but they go back to the Sulaco as the plant explodes.
Which has also got a big theme. I mean, we haven't actually talked about the music from James Horner, who was like everywhere in the 80s doing rock and everything. It's one thing I noticed when I was sort of watching it for this, is that we all remember the big theme from this film, particularly at the end and the marching charge and everything. But throughout the film, the score is virtually non-existent. It relies really heavily on sound effects more than it does an underlying musical sort of tempo or everything to it. I mean, Horner didn't have particularly long to do the score for the film, and I think he was satisfied. When it does hit and you get that big that fanfare coming out, particularly as, you know, Punch It, and they're coming out of there, it really, really helps the whole thing, and it's, you know, swelling with it as it goes.
When you think that he did soundtracks for, you know, he and Jerry Goldsmith between them did most of the films of the 80s, it seems. You know, Horner had done, well, he'd done Commando before this, and he did the Titanic one, didn't
yes,
he, as well?
Yes, Jim Cameron. Yeah, I think after this, him and Cameron had a bit of a falling out, and I think it wasn't until Titanic time that they decided to work together. I think Cameron liked what Horner had done on Braveheart, and they decided, right, let's see if we can work on Titanic, and they did.
Oh, good. Well, I suppose fans of Celine Dion will rejoice.
Well, two of them, yes.
Now, when they get back up to the Sulaco, and as we know from the previous film and subsequent films, the alien's very adaptable, and it turns out she'd latched onto the craft as it escaped. She spikes Bishop with her sort of scorpion tail, rips him in half. Luckily, he's an android. And Newt goes to hide, and Ripley goes off as well, hiding. And this is... going to use that word again, iconic. But if you could, you know, one line from the film that Ripley
yes.
has,
yeah.
she, you know, we already know from an earlier scene that she, you know, she knows how to work these sort of robotic
loaders. Yeah.
You know, and she comes out, you know, with the light behind her, like something out of a Gladiator movie. I mean, I didn't mention the fact that she's wearing Reebok trainers throughout, which very much grounds it in sort of middle England. But, you know, she comes out just saying, get away from her, you bitch.
Yeah.
Which, from her, sounds even better.
Get away from her, you bitch!
Just so perfect that, you know, it's a you know,
yeah.
playing a mum... fighting another mum. It's like something you get out of the Queen Vic with Barbara Windsor.
Yeah, or outside the school gates when the parking space has been taken.
And the fight that they have, you know, essentially now Ripley is, I wouldn't say physically the equal, but she has enough now that she can fight the Queen. This isn't just about her in the first film where she's in a tiny pants hiding in a spacesuit.
Yeah,
you know, she's full on going head to head with this alien queen. Fantastic.
Yeah. Proper evolution of the character, as we've sort of talked about earlier. She's got to the point now where she is facing off against her absolute nemesis of the species, and she has the ability to do it. And it's a brilliant face off. It absolutely is.
And the fight, you know, and again, you know, there's only so much you can do. We're in a spaceship, of course, an airlock is always the handy escape, whether we're talking the first movie or Moonraker or anything like that, or anything in between. Airlocks come in very handy in these films.
Yes, yes. I'm actually glad it didn't sort of go down the Moonraker route. That would have been a bit,
I don't know. It would have been nice if the alien had said something about ruined my attempts for an amusing death. Luckily, you know, as the airlock is opened and the alien has pulled Ripley in, Ripley escapes, and Bishop's, I think his upper half, still functioning, manages to grab Newt while she's about to get pulled out into the airlock. Again, and I use this phrase on most episodes, I'm not a scientist, but I don't really know. I mean, if an airlock works like that, how do you survive? I don't know. Would you?
Well,
bear in mind, I've recently watched Total Recall, and that sentence came up several times at the end when they're in Mars with no air. So, but yeah, luckily, Newt is saved by Bishop. Ripley manages to escape. The alien is blasted into outer space, and we get a fairly happy ending.
Yeah, happy ending. Hicks is all bandaged up in his overall as well, so he can't mansplain for the rest of the journey home, and it's all good.
Yeah, we've got Bishop looking like a boil in the bag chicken in a cryotube. We get the return of Ripley's pants.
The return of Ripley's pants should have been the tagline for this film.
That would have got even more people in to see it.
Absolutely, yeah.
And yeah, I mean the whole cryopod thing, and it's you know, this is the sort of pros and cons of coming back to this film years later when we know, having seen Alien 3, we know what happens. It's not good. But it is, you know, when you look at this and how they escape and they go off and drift off in their cryopods and everything, the ending is similar to the first movie.
Yes.
You've got Newt instead of a cat, but I think it's enough to kind of remind you that, you know, no matter how different the film got from the original at certain points, it's still an alien film. It still ends with Sigourney Weaver in her pants in a cryotube, which to some people is all they could ask for.
The whole film is literature. It tries desperately to be its own thing, and it succeeds so much, but there's lots of nice little nods, and it's actually almost reassuring at the end that you get a very similar ending to that in the previous film. It sort of completes the experience, and they do very much. The more I watch the other pair of them, they aren't very much back to back films, completely different, but just enough sort of linking them to that they're almost the same.
I won't talk about Alien 3 too much. I mean, there's so many other podcasts will talk about that and articles and stuff. I mean, I don't mind Alien 3. I know some people hate it, and
I enjoy it. Yeah,
and there is a version that I haven't seen that is a lot more closer to what David Fincher had in mind, which I haven't seen and should really try and hunt down. But I mean, the idea that the prison planet and everything is I suppose, again, how do you, you know, it's hard enough beating one alien film. How do you beat the two, or how do you better it, or how do you make it significantly different? But I mean, I have no beef with it at all. I mean, the fourth one is rubbish, but the third one, I have time for, and I'll watch it if it's on telly.
It's a nice little sort of trilogy. It almost, well, it does complete, for me, the Ripley arc, particularly with the ending of Alien 3, and then, you know, the fourth one is just the Bobby Ewing coming out of the shower dream sequence from Dallas. It's just, it exists, but not in the real world, potentially.
Yeah, but I mean, speaking of real world, we've got a woman with large hair wearing Reebok trainers fighting an alien in outer space. It's I'll tell you what, I mean, having watched this film again, I haven't watched Alien, the first one, all the way through in quite some time, and I feel like I might go and do that. But I mean, as a separate piece, as a separate film, I can't think of many, and I'll say Terminator 2 is probably one of the few examples, another Cameron thing, where they've taken, you know, unlike Rambo, where they've gone from one film, they've gone a completely different way. And
yeah,
some may say that didn't work. First Blood 2 is an experience. It's not a better film. There's a lot more death and Steven Berkoff, but but whereas they've taken the original and turned it into something, I won't say better, but something that's as good and as entertaining, but
very much, they've given it its own purpose. They haven't, as you say, they haven't sort of retrod the old ground just to make money. The first film didn't make a huge amount of money. There wasn't a huge amount of sort of interest in a sequel at first. It was sort of the persistence of Cameron and what he was going to do with it, and obviously Terminator helped, and he realised an expansion of the original story, but both of them completely stand on their own right.
Well, I'll thank you for bringing the extended edition of Betamax, which will take a little bit longer to rewind. Now, Simon, where can people find you on social media? And more importantly, what sort of jokes are you doing for us today?
Jokes. They can find me off. Yeah. I should have just clarified at the start. I'm not that one.
Yes.
Yeah, they can. Yeah, they can find me on Twitter at Simon_Peg. I will sort of happily converse with everyone. Twitter is basically just a nice little room for jokes. And it's only the second place, other than the Alien franchise, where the eggs are the most annoying part of it, which is on Twitter, which usually sort of like football logos. I just enjoy Twitter. It's a lovely experience. I've sort of found Betamax Pod and a few other podcasts, and particularly in the spirit of lockdown, it's helped the time fly by in a very entertaining way.
Well, thank you for that, and I'm definitely going to use the example of eggs being there. That's if we can describe Twitter in one sentence. Yeah, although the football club logos are just as bad, as you say.
Some of them, not all of them, not all of them.
Yeah, well, it depends if you're Chelsea or Arsenal, I suppose. But
I'm not getting involved in that.
Now, as we discussed earlier on, the number one song when this film came out. Now, this came out on the 29th of August, 1986. It was I Want to Wake Up With You, which was Boris Gardner, which, the name of the song is actually quite appropriate. But I had played that at the end of the flight, the Navigator episode, which came out the same weekend. But as Simon mentioned beforehand, there is a song by Al Matthews, who played the sergeant, which came out in July 1975, called Fool. Now, I think that's far more appropriate, and it's got to get a bit more Sergeant in. So
yeah, that'd be great, and I'm glad you chose that and not his follow-up single, which was called Us Holes and Elbows, people.
I don't know, that could be the B-side. If we put that on Patreon, that could be the end of that one. anyway, Simon, thank you very much.
No, thank you, Rich. It's been an absolute pleasure.
I'll speak to you soon.
Take care. Well, I guess I really when I could have been the star of your show. She said,
this podcast was brought to you by executive producers Gary West, Keith Foster, Jimmy Fletcher, Mark Drakes, Matt Cullington, Christian Dees, Chris Hopkins, Omar Zambon, Ian Madrell, Katrin Lowe, Mark Makin, Zoltan Vargo, Simon Smith, Laurie Curran, Wayne McNally, Darren Hodgkins, Dan Wellington, Alex Heal, Philip Roffenberger, Alan Fewings, Peter Climie, Tom Carr, James Kennedy, associate producer Chris Oakley. Visit patreon.com/Betamax Video Club for more information about bonus episodes, early access, discounted merchandise and more.